This week on Houston Newsmakers, Houston Police Chief Troy Finner. It was 1 year ago this week when Troy Finner was sworn in as chief of the Houston Police Department. Much has happened since then. We'll talk about it this morning. As Houston murders continue at an unacceptable high rate, the challenge of reducing that rate and keeping criminals behind bars when perceived gaps in the judicial system make the challenge more difficult. What's the answer to that question? And much more on this week's Houston Newsmakers.
From KPRC-2, this is Houston Newsmakers with Khambrel Marshall.
It was a year ago this week when Troy Finner was sworn in as chief of the Houston Police Department. It was a day of professional achievement for Finner, who joined HPD in 1990, worked his way up to the ranks of becoming Houston's top cop. And now what? Well, I'm glad to welcome Chief Finner to Houston Newsmakers. Good to see you in person on this set. It's been a while.
Hey, thank you, Khambrel, and it's a pleasure being here.
It is always nice to see you. Yeah. You know, I want to talk about the challenges that you face as a chief, but before I get into that, I want to step back in time a bit. Okay, let's go back to that day in 1990 when you joined HPD. Hiram Clark, pride of Hiram Clark, 5th Ward, hopes and dreams. What were your thoughts as this young cop stepping into the HPD?
Hey, no one in my family was a police officer, so I'm first generation. So a lot of memories, but what I remembered mostly is just wanting to get back into my community, a city that I love, and do something positive. It just happened to be a police officer. I remember my mother, my father, and my family. We're in unknown territory. You know, we didn't have police officers in the family. And I remember my mom just being really nervous. And I told her, I says, Mom, we're Christian people. We're gonna be fine. Mm-hmm. And she saw it after months on and years on. It was the right thing for me and the right thing for our family as well.
What, was there one catalyst? Was a person or was something that tipped you to go into police? I mean, what was it that?
I just remember being in college because I didn't set out to be a police officer. And like I said, I didn't have any relatives or anything, but I took a serial murder class in college and it really piqued my interest. And I thought, well, hey, this is something that I might want to do for a career. Mm-hmm. I think that was the start of it. But I look at it at 32 years later. I'm so glad that I chose this career. I really am.
Well, now, here we are now. You are a year into the job as chief. You've seen many homicides under your watch. What do you remember about the numbers, the homicide numbers, when you took over as, and this was just as former Chief Acevedo was leaving, saying, oh, these numbers are going to go higher. And you get into it, and now there's a reality that these numbers have been unacceptably high.
I remember in 2021, there were predictions that it was going to go over 500. And the numbers are important, but sometimes we get too involved in the numbers and we get away from people and the pain that it's caused. So every murder in this city affects me as the police chief, but it also affects those family members. So I look at every murder, and I think we all need to be intentional in doing everything that we can possibly do to prevent. And once those murders occur, we all have to get in the fight to make sure we solve those and holding people accountable in our city.
You've often talked about community involvement to help in the homicide rate. What does that look like? What do you mean by that?
Basically, if you see something, you say something, it's so simple, a simple saying, but what does it mean in reality? It means involving yourself, not being so fearful. Having enough trust and belief in the police department that if you give us the right information, we're going to get out there and we're going to hold people accountable. You can't allow a few criminals to consume and take over our cities and take over our communities. So it's just people getting together, but it's a big responsibility is upon police officers. Mm-hmm. Though, we have to make sure that we're extending ourselves and engaging ourselves in all communities. All communities in this city, so people will have enough respect and trust that they will come forward.
And that trust thing is a key word, isn't it? I mean, it takes a while. It's not a short-term kind of thing, especially in some of the communities in Houston. There are folks who don't have any trust at all for cops.
Well, I want to put some perspective to that, too. There are a few But I know this city. I've been here all my life, and the truth of it is, in most communities, the great majority of people, they really respect the police. Mm-hmm. It's just a few of them that's angry, that raise a lot of noise. And so I want us to put that in perspective. But if we have any person in our community that don't trust us, we got to do everything we can do to build that trust, mm-hmm. because we can't do it alone.
Yeah.
We cannot do it alone.
Well, that's a challenge that continues, and we continue to see the murder rates are still not where they need to be. You would say that if you have one, that's too much, I'm sure. How do you measure progress? We have a homicide rate, you have crime in general. What is your measure of progress about where we are as far as the city?
Well, look, I measure that progress, and this is something that's difficult to measure, but when the citizens start feeling more secure, okay? But let's back up a little bit. Let's look at some numbers. Last year, 2021, everything that was going on with the backlog and all the other challenges we have with COVID and everything else, we were able to end 2021 with our violent crime numbers down almost 5%. That got kind of lost in a lot of the noise. And I want to give credit to the community first and our great men and women on the front line and our support teams. I want to say thank them, a big thanks to them. Property crimes were down 3%. Mm-hmm. Now, you remember at the first 3 weeks of 2022, we had a terrible weekend, but we had so many homicides and we had some terrible numbers. And people started saying, well, Houston is the capital, the murder capital of the nation. And I said, look, just slow down a little bit. This is just 3 weeks of 52 weeks. We're going to keep working hard with our citizens, and we're going to get things turned around. As today, I didn't look at the numbers this morning, but as yesterday, I think we were at 10% as compared to last year. So in January, during those weeks, we were at 70-some percent. So those numbers are trending in the right direction. Let me thank the mayor, Turner, and our city council for giving us support, One Safe Houston, giving us overtime dollars to put more officers out there on the streets.
Right.
It's helping.
And I want to stop you for a second, because I know one of the things the city's trying to do is through the One Safe program. Yes. I want you to take a look now at when those plans were announced. We have a little bit of video.
We will not allow criminals to take over our city.
That was back in February when the One Safe program was announced by Mayor Turner, putting more than $40 million to work to help fight violent crime and other things. That announcement made with much fanfare about the effort that's going on, and that has to be part of what is continuing to help lower the crime rates now, is it not? What's more, what's involved in this One Safe? It's a name, but what's more into it?
To me, the most important thing is a comprehensive initiative. It's not just police. You didn't see him just giving the overtime dollars to, it's a social issue. You know, it's just not a police issue. Everybody has to get in here, the social agencies, everybody else. So I'm very proud of that, dealing with people who are suffering from mental illness, dealing with unemployment. All of that stuff goes into reducing crime, and especially when you're looking at homicide. Mm-hmm. It's a relationship crime. Most people who, and I'm not blaming the victims, I want to be clear of that, but most people, the suspect, there's some type of relationship with the victim and the suspect. Sometimes it's in criminal enterprise, sometimes it's domestics. I'm also very proud of us funding more of our DART program. That's a program where we have clinicians in the cars with patrol officers, and they go to the scenes. Okay. That is huge, because you know domestic violence is a cycle. And if you don't get those victims the help that they need right away, so we're going out there. Since I've been chief, we've responded to over 1,700 scenes where we're getting individuals help. Now, those numbers on domestic violence, assaults, and homicides are still too high, but they would be higher without this DART program. And I'm very proud of that. And the mayor's funded that. Also, dealing with those individuals who are suffering from mental illness. Mm-hmm. A lot of that money is going to that and helping us, because The police were never designed, never, to deal with people who are really suffering from mental illness. Get those social agencies and those individuals in that are trained to help us deal with that. And I'm really happy and proud of that. And I think you'll see some great results here going forward.
Well, it looks like we are at this point. I want to continue that conversation in a bit more with Chief Finner after the break, when we'll talk about the angst in dealing with his officers in the line of fire, putting their lives on the line, how much more can be done to protect them and the public, when Houston Newsmakers continues. This is the visual no one likes to see. Services for HPD officer William Jeffrey killed last September in the line of duty. It's something all police officers know. That's the job is dangerous, but all go to work every day expecting to return home. Chief, talk about the difficulty of talking to a wife or family of an officer who dies in the line of duty. I can't imagine how challenging that is.
Unfortunately, I've been there, and I'm looking at the tape right now, and Bill, who we referred to him, Big Bill, Jeffrey, I meant to say, what an officer, what a great man, but it is so difficult when you have to go in and give that news to a family member. So difficult, and unfortunately, since I've been to police in Houston, the police chief, I'm sorry, in Houston-Harris County, 6 line of duty deaths, 5 to gunfire, and our constable just over a week ago to a DWI suspect. I've been there for HPD and other agencies as well. It's always the most difficult time when you gotta give that news to a wife, the kids, mom and dad, and it's just something that you hope and you pray that that don't happen again. Mm-hmm. But you understand that we're in difficult times.
Yeah.
We really are.
Challenges are all abound. And one of the things that I know that you're challenged with is trying to get people in jail and keep them in jail. You've been vocal about bail system as being perhaps one of the problems. One of my Facebook friends, Jason Stacy, sent in a message. He said he wants to know, how do you feel about the low bonds that judges give to people accused of violent crimes?
I'm not going to just say judges. I'm really intentional about not blaming, because it's problems all around. But we have to do something about bond and bail. The bail bonding industry, they don't get a pass, because when judges are doing the right thing and giving proper bond, we've always been in a system where it was 10%. Now it's 3%, 2%, and sometimes 1%. That's just not right. It's not right.
So somebody may get a high bond and they have to pay 1% of whatever that
1%
bond is?
And there's even payment programs. But let me ask you this. If this violent offender, he is not a working individual right now. You don't have a job. So what are you doing? You're encouraging him to go out and commit more crimes because now he's on his payment system, like he's making a car note, and he goes out and commit more. So it's a system that we gotta look at, and we gotta change it immediately.
I don't think a lot of people know that.
No.
That's something that people aren't really
I'm gonna continue
with.
To be, just to voice it out. I really am.
This whole process going forward now, let me ask you this. We have a Newsmakers Extra, by the way, because a lot of times when we have conversations like this, there's so much to talk about, so we're going to do a little bit extra. But is there anything you've learned about the city of Houston that you didn't know as chief, which is different than what you knew as a cop coming up the ranks?
No. It's the one thing that I did learn. I'm sleep deprived, okay? I knew that this is a great city. And I still know that today. The heart of this city, whatever we go through, we hang in there together. And that's a beautiful thing. And we're gonna get through the times that we're going through right now. But it's a city in which people help other people. But I wanna remind them of how great we are in this fight against violent crime. Let's continue to remain together, mm-hmm. support one another, and making sure if you're a little bit better off than people, more fortunate for the moment, reach your hand into their families, people who are less fortunate, or into their neighborhoods, and help them. And far as the criminal justice family, and I'm gonna say family today, Let's all work together. Let's stop pointing fingers. Let me tell you what my challenges are. Mm-hmm. As the chief of police, you helped me out. I just had a meeting with our DA before I came here. We're working together. Our judges, we all need to be working together in a system that was based and founded upon our U.S. Constitution. But it has to get back to victim-centric. The suspects have rights, but it has to be victim-centric.
We're going to talk more about that on Houston Newsmakers Extra. Troy Fenner, thank you. Good luck in your continued leadership with this great community and with this great force of all of your officers. Look forward to seeing great things from you in the city.
Thank you again. My pleasure. Thank you for what you do.